bathhouse. Yeah. Yeah. All right, you guys. Thank you for hanging out. Oh. Come on, Derek.
Hey.
What's up?
Oh my gosh. Hey, what you up to?
I haven't seen you in so long.
It has been forever, hasn't it?
I'm not on TikTok anymore. I'm not.
I know.
I only get on here literally to post a video. And then I'm out of here. I am not sticking around for it. none of it.
I feel that.
I refuse. I unsubscribe to the drama.
I seen that video. You know what? I doff my hat to you.
I mean, before I got on TikTok, the reason why I have not been on TikTok is because I've been trying to get my brain to function like it did prior to ever getting on this app.
Right.
Because this app changes the way your brain functions. All of them do. Social media changes how your brain functions. Mm-hmm. And, I went through a lot of ups and downs on this app. That's an understatement. But it did a lot of damage over time. It did a lot of damage to me emotionally, right? So when I open this app, I feel like I'm having a panic attack. Like I have full-on PTSD panic attacks just from opening this app. Like before I go live, I have a panic attack. I'm like, I don't think I should go live.
Hey, Tootsie. Yeah, I think somebody tried to block a random person and they accidentally got you instead. Okay, so, but you look good, you know? It must be the time away from all the bullshit.
You have to recharge. Everyone has to recharge. Everyone has to take a break. It is so that's the thing about being a content creator. You know, we're living in a world now where anyone can be a star.
Oh, yeah.
Everyone is a star. Everyone has something to say, you know? Oh, yeah. And that's beautiful. I love that we live in a world where everyone has a platform to be able to be creative, to be able to speak their mind. Within the parameters of artificial intelligence. I think it's beautiful that people can share themselves. Mm-hmm. But you know what? This is good. This is what I came to the conclusion. All of the drama and stuff that you see on TikTok and all of the yelling and screaming and all of the fighting, it's actually really, really good.
Yeah, it is.
I think there's going to be a positive outcome.
Why do you think I do what I do on here?
I think people eventually are going to get tired. Right. Yeah. No, I get it. I get it. Yeah. You know what? And God bless you. God bless you for it. Absolutely not. I refuse to do what you do. So.
if Spirit did not bring it to me to bring to my plate all the time, I wouldn't have nothing to do with it either. You know, but it was always like it started with you and it kept on going after that. And I think it's because giving people a moment to just get all their words out, even if it's just word vomit, you know, it makes them feel hurt in some way and it allows them to get it off their chest. But whenever they're like a broken record, I ended up blocking people after all of that. I ended up blocking people because they kept on trying to come in and start it, you know, and I'm all like, listen, I had two people come into my life not that long ago, and they were just too busy screaming over each other. They didn't hear each other. So I muted them and I told them, I said, what y'all need to do is take this off of the app. Y'all need to write it out to each other so that way y'all can actually read and understand and come to an understanding with each other.
Yeah.
But I don't know if they ever did that or not, but I was just all like, y'all got to situate this off of the app because y'all ain't getting no kind of progress and I don't see it going anywhere. So we're going to move on from this.
Well, yeah, of course. And basically what you're seeing is you're actually seeing the real maturity level of most people.
Yeah, which is scary. But, you know, I have made a lot of changes myself.
Good for you.
And ceremonies in April.
Yay, you're gonna get crowned?
I don't know. It's just whatever comes out on the mat.
Good.
You know how it goes.
Oh, okay. And you're working with Rachel, right?
Yeah, I'm actually gonna go to, it's the, I think it's her 12th or 13th Ocho birthday.
Oh, good.
So I'll be there for drumming and everything. I'm so excited.
Oh, good.
Yeah. Good.
Yeah, she's a really, really great priestess and crowned my friend. I did his Lavato Santo or Santo Lavato. I can't remember exactly what they call it. So good. Good for you. You found someone that knows their shit and is serious about it.
People. You know, it's funny because I ended up doing a prayer. I ended up asking Spirit, I said, bring to me somebody that is going to be really good in guiding me through this process. You know, somebody that's trustworthy, you know, and literally not a week later, she popped up, you know, and then she was coming into the live. And then it was just like, I felt like I could trust her with anything. You know,
and that's how I feel about my priestess. I love my priestess and I love my Ile. I love my house. I love the tradition I'm a part of now. I feel very connected. I feel at home, and your Ori will lead you to the right place eventually.
Yeah.
Eventually.
Yeah.
You just have to, because the thing was, is I tried to get crowned in Lukumi three times, and every single time
something happened.
Yeah. And let me tell you something, when that happens, that means Spirit is saying, you're going in the wrong direction. You need to turn around.
Yeah.
Okay. Or it's saying you need to reevaluate how you're going about doing this thing. Right. Okay. So after the third time of failure, and it was my spirits. After the third time, I went to Arun Mila and I was like, I need you to give me the priestess that's going to crown me. I need a spiritual guide that is going to guide me to where I need to go. And you know, the next day I opened up the app and I was flipping through the app and I landed on Naya. And she was talking about Ifa. And I was like, oh, wow, look, another Orisha person, right? So then I started watching her videos and I started interacting with her. And then I was like, I really want to get a reading from this person because I want to talk to them. I want to hear how they read. I want to see what kind of information comes out. We had interactions with one another. And then I joined her mentorship program. I joined her house. I got my hand of Ifa a second time, because when you change traditions, you have to get the hand of Ifa again, because you don't get the same things.
Right. You get different things. Right. Yeah.
So, and I'm very, very happy. I don't have any regrets about my spiritual path. I have not made, hold on, let me put it to you like this, Derek. What I'm trying to say is that I regret a lot of things, but I don't regret the decisions that I've made on my spiritual path. That's what I'm saying.
Sure.
Because people might have looked at me and said, wow, he's making a mistake. It wasn't a mistake. It might have been a mistake for them. It wasn't a mistake for me, because I still ended up where I was supposed to be. Do you know what I'm saying?
Exactly. Exactly.
So I'm very happy with my spirituality. I'm very happy working with my priestess. I'm very with both my priestesses. I have a Mambo and I have an Ianifa, and I'm happy. So both of those women have just mellowed me out. And let me tell you something, though. Let me tell you something. It is such a relief to hand over. Okay, I know this is going to sound so not like me. It was such a relief for me to hand over my spirituality into Naya's hands and say, just tell me what to do and I'll do it.
Yeah.
It took such a burden off of me having to
when you surrender
by myself. I wasn't by myself anymore.
Yeah.
And I have put Naya and Laloon in charge of my spirituality. Wow. Okay. So all I have to do is do what my priestesses tell me to do and I'm fine.
Yeah.
I don't have to worry. Yeah. And I don't have to be confused about what I'm doing next. And that's the beautiful thing about having a spiritual guide. You know,
that's so beautiful. I'm so happy for you. I really am. And you seem so good. You have a beautiful light all around you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. There was a lot of dark spirits around me for a long time. They needed to go. They need to get cleaned off. Exorcism. I'm talking deliverance. Okay.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
And there were cords that needed to be cut. Yeah. Negative energy in my life that needed to go, because it was dragging me down and it was also blocking me from being able to see what I needed to do spiritually for myself.
Right.
I don't feel like the same person today that you knew even 3 months ago.
Same. Isn't it funny how that works? That's so funny how that works. You know, I was actually talking to Rachel just the other day about how different everything is. Like, I mean, I've gone to therapy, you know.
Good.
And I've gotten a lot more understanding about why I was feeling so hostile, you know. I got to understand why I was feeling the way I was feeling, and I understand now that more than anything, it was one, I was too far from my family, everything that I grew up knowing, my roots, all that. I wasn't in a place where I felt like as if my space was secure, you know, like anybody could have just said, oh, you got to go, you got to leave, we're kicking you out. It was always the threat always looming in the air over me. And that was too much. Right. And I'm the kind of person, like, I want to feed everybody, you know, I want to make sure everybody's got food, everybody's got water, everybody's, you know, lights, internet, everything, rent, everything paid for. So I put too much stress on myself. I took on too much of that burden. And especially with going through a spiritual transition, that's the last thing that you need in your life, is having all that stress on you. And because it will break you. You know, I went through a psychosis and I broke down. And, you know.
It feels great, doesn't it? Doesn't it feel great having a meltdown? It feels so good after.
Oh, afterwards? After everything settles? Yes, afterwards. Not during, not just before.
No.
But after.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I had a bad psychic explosion. Mm-hmm. It was bad. It was not psychological, a psychic explosion. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I think that created a massive ripple effect that affected a lot of people that were indirectly or directly involved with everything that happened. So a lot of people ended up taking a step back. And I respect that. I love that. I love that they did that. But I had to seek magical help, you know, some spiritual help to help gain control over that. Because that was, I had like people coming to me 2-3 times a week asking me if I was attacking them in the astral, asking me if I was throwing bad magics at them. And I told them, I was like, I've just been here trying to just sort out the chaos in my own life right now, like putting all the pieces together, going to therapy, doing cleansings. That's all I've been doing. And they're like, well, something keeps attacking me with your face. Come find out. Shadow self. It was, as I was asleep, I was probably doing something in my unconscious state. And had some confirmations done. I didn't know what to do. I had no idea. And, you know, I want to tell you something funny. About a week ago, I was going through my mind about like how everybody was just far away. And I was all like feeling like I was starting to come into a space where I was growing, you know, and starting to really get into this space. And I ended up going into a video where I was going to make a video about it. And I was all like, I feel like I was once part of a big old beautiful forest, and now it's like an updraft wind ripped me out and took me over here, and the water is flowing and it's beautiful, it's nourishing, but there's nobody else around, but there's plenty of room to grow. And as soon as I said that, I stopped recording a video, I deleted it, and I was just like spirit took me out of a situation so that a way I could learn to stand on my own and grow my own roots and dig down deep, spread my wings out. Because I know that I was leaning on a lot of y'all. You know, I was leaning on a lot of y'all.
Not on me. I didn't feel any kind of pressure in any kind of way.
I feel like I was leaning on y'all. You know, I feel like I was. I feel like, and I think that really that had more to do, I think that's why spirit wanted me to do that, was so that a way I could get out of that space where I felt like I wasn't in the right space. You know what I mean? So it took me some time, took me a lot of, I had to get off of this app for a while. I mean, I would post videos and everything like that, but I wouldn't go live. And if I did, it was just for like maybe 30 seconds or something like that. And then I would just hop off. But aside from just maintaining appearance for content, that was it. I didn't go live for like 3 months. And I just tended to myself, did self-care. And it's better. It's great. Mm-hmm. Got this. I don't even think you can see
it. Oh, I can see it. Oh, it's beautiful. I see it. It's a forest.
Yeah. And check this out. I'm not done yet, but there's that. So, I have fairy lights back behind it.
Oh, that's so cute.
All the way throughout the whole thing, I'm going to have it all situated. So, I'm pretty excited about that. Getting it all situated right now. I give you the grand tour. So the kitchen,
beautiful.
The living room,
and, it looks great.
Oh my gosh, it's getting there. We're still getting things together. Of course, had to get one, right?
So cute.
And it changes colors for ambiance. Of course. I love it. This is the office, which is going to eventually be my santo room, where I keep my saints and everything once I get it all situated. But it's going
to be nice. You got a lot of space.
I'm going to put my ancestors over here. And then I'll have this window And then I'll have all my saints and everything over here.
That looks great.
Yeah, I'm excited. And of course, gotta have Grogu. You must. I don't know what to do with the little man. We're gonna be hanging him up somewhere around here. Oy vey. But I'm excited. I really am. It's been a long time just sorting through everything. Oh, I'm in good spiritual baths now.
Nice. Where are you selling them? Because I will totally buy one from you.
This one is a rompimiento right here. Road opener and cleanser. And I've added quite a bit of stuff into this. I let it cook for like a few days after a few days of me blessing my stuff. And it's got that licorice smell, so you know it's gonna cleanse that shit off. It's really wonderful. But it will attract money too, which I'm excited about. Third eye activation meditation oil. I've had so many people buy so much, I had to make a brand new fresh amount of product. And I'm doing spiritual soaks, like salt baths, stuff like that. I'm just doing it. I'm doing the things. I don't
I'm gonna send you a care package. I'm gonna send you something. I'm gonna send you a little gift. So on Facebook, you're gonna have to send me a message to let me know what your address is, so I can help. So I can send you something. Look at that. That's cute.
I made this myself, right? So I bought the fairy lights, right? But I went to the Dollar Tree and got the glass bottle, and I just stuffed it up in there and just put it in there. And I'm just like, I love the whole.
That's fairy really light cute. Yeah.
We're gonna have two of them. One right there, one on the other end, and we have a big old 75-inch screen TV that's going to go right here. So it's going to create a beautiful ambiance going on. I have like my mock altar right here, which I have to turn on my little electric candles. These things are cool because you got like a thing right here.
How long have you been in this new place?
2 months.
Nice.
2 months, yeah. And like that's the bathroom, but I keep a candle in here because, you know, whenever I wake up at night or something like that and I have to go to, so that's our number two bathroom where we do number two because it actually flushes twice on its own.
Oh
yeah, the other one, that's for number one.
That's funny.
Yeah,
that's hysterical.
And it only flushed once. Yeah, we don't have washer and dryers. We're gonna wait until we get into a house. But yeah, we just got a new dresser to put in the bedroom, which I'm excited about. I have a new partner.
Yay.
He's amazing.
Good.
He is. He's very, very amazing. He caught me shortly after about my third or fourth therapy session. I think it was probably my fifth because I started like probably a week or two after I left California, got back to Texas. That's whenever I got started on that. I couldn't figure out how to get around it, you know, by myself. So I was like, well, this is, I need a licensed professional.
Here's the thing. This is how I feel.
Have you read
Nana's book, Nana the Witch's book? Have you read The Quantum Witch? Because it's a fantastic book.
She and I have actually gone deep into detail about that.
About the quantum stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's not a joke.
No, it's not. It's really not.
And that's what I'm here to tell you. Getting therapy, getting people who specialize in helping people get around their issues or getting on medication that's going to keep you, like, you can't walk around crazy. You need to, like, have that under control in order to be able to be a spiritualist. People always ask me, is taking medication going to affect my ability to see shit? And I'm like, not if you're a real psychic. Not if you're a real psychic. So, yeah, medication is good. And that's, I recommend everyone get a therapist. I recommend everybody get help. There are a lot of people, witches on this app, that need therapy. They don't need witchcraft. They need therapy.
I've told a few people that too, that they need therapy. And they're just like, ha ha ha, you're so funny. I was trying to be a comedian.
Yeah, for real. Yeah.
You don't see me on a stand up doing stand up on a stage.
Your mental and behavioral health is important, and the spiritual world and the physical world are one and the same. It's intimately connected and entwined with one another. We're entangled with one another. So yeah.
I actually spoke about that in one of my lives about a week ago. I was talking about how everything is interconnected, like all throughout the universe, it's all connected. And I said, what do you see between you and the wall, right? Nothing. It's just, you see the wall. But everything right between me and that wall is filled with energy.
Mm-hmm.
It is filled all the way from the outside to the inside, to the other side of the world and back again. So some of the videos I've posted where I'm all like, maybe protected from the top of your head to the soles of your feet, from the inside to the outside to the other side and back again. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
I'm speaking that everything around them, within them, aids in protecting them.
Yeah. Yeah, that's, people don't understand that what they don't see, there is more that exists in what you don't see than what actually exists that you can see, because most everything is space. Exactly. Matter is actually a very, very, very small amount of the universe.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the thing is people don't realize they're surrounded by spirits all the time. Spirits of nature, ancestors, spirits of the dead. Spirits that have good intentions, spirits that have bad intentions. People forget that there are spirits of misfortune out there. We have names for them. That they exist for the purpose of destruction.
They do. Their sole purpose is to distract us from elevating. They don't want us to elevate. They want us to fail.
Yeah, and continue to wander around in darkness all the time. Yeah.
Right.
So people need to understand that their physical body and their physical surroundings matter all the time.
Yes, absolutely. So like whenever I was out in the woods, right? At my house in the woods, I was in a very stagnant space. There was no flow. Not to mention the internet sucked. So, of course, there wasn't going to be no flow. But on top of that, I'm talking more like interaction, like a flow of energy between me and another individual. You know, there wasn't no flow. So at that point, I was like, Spirit, I need something more than just this. You know, I need something that's going to set me on my path, because I want to be the best version of myself that I can be right now, right? The best version of myself that I can be right now. Not today, well, not tomorrow, not next week, not next month, but today, right now, I want to be the best version of myself that I can be today. And that's all I need to be for today. And then tomorrow, be a little bit better. All I can do. And not to say that I don't have setbacks, because I do, but I'm aware enough, I'm conscientious enough in order to recognize whenever I need to take a step back, you know.
I have learned several valuable lessons. This past year has been emotionally hard for me. I've had a really tough mental health year. This has not been an easy mental health year for me either. There are at least three times over the past year that I could have totally gone to the hospital, and had a meltdown without taking like my risperidone and anxiety medication to keep me from popping off, right? But let me tell you something funny. I had this grand epiphany. I was standing in my kitchen. I was making my morning cup of coffee and I was thinking to myself, and I thought to myself, Ryan, if some other motherfucker came to you and bought a reading and asked you to help them find a solution to their problems, which are my problems, right? If someone came to you and told you that what was going on in their life, what advice would you give them? Why aren't you taking your own advice? Why can't you take the advice that you give to other people? Why? What is the mechanism in you that overrides when something in the back of your mind or heart says, don't do it? Come on. And I had to figure out what that was. Yeah. I had to figure out why I wasn't listening to my own alarm, why I was not listening to my own inner wisdom teacher and taking that advice.
Right.
Everybody needs to figure out why.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, whenever you don't know why you feel the way you feel, you need to backtrack and see what might have, where it might be stemming from. I had to do that. I had to get away from the situation first. Spirit took me out of the situation to help me realize what happened. I was shattered before I ever met, you know, I was shattered. I was distraught. I had went through hell, you know, and unfortunately, you know, I allowed it to affect me, which ended up destroying something that was really beautiful, you know. And so, but I also recognize that Spirit introduced us for a reason, mm-hmm. you know.
Spirit yeah.
introduced us so that a way we could gain an experience from each other, so that a way we could add that to ourselves, so we could elevate. It's not necessarily like, oh, I'm supposed to be with this person for the rest of my life. It was, I needed that exchange of energy from that person. I needed that experience with them. So that a way I could gain the wisdom I needed and they could gain the wisdom that they needed in order for us to both grow and become whatever it is that we're supposed to be.
Yeah.
And that's hard. That's a hard, gosh, that was such a hard pill for me to swallow. That was one of the hardest pills for me to swallow. And it took hours of therapy. Mm-hmm. Hours. And mm-hmm. then a lot of shadow work. I was actually talking to, I actually had a few people come up in my life probably a few days ago, and they were trying to bad talk them. And I was like, hey, I don't want anybody feeling no kind of bad vibe toward him at all, because he responded the best way that he could, you know, to my psychotic break. He responded the best way that he could. He probably responded in a better way than I could have. You know what I mean? So I respect and thank him for that. You know, I thank him for that, mm-hmm. because I wouldn't be who I am now had he not. I probably would have been in a ditch somewhere. You know, I probably would have myself out. I would have took myself out, you know? So I'm glad he did what he did. And Not to mention, you know, I think it honestly was what was supposed to happen the whole time. You know, it wasn't supposed to be like him and I together. It was supposed to be me to create a middle ground so that a way he could get to where he had to be. You know what I mean? Kind of like I'm an island between two continents. You know, it was just a bit of foundation to rest and gain some stability, and then they can get to a much more stable space.
So the thing is that relationships are 50-50. You bring 50% to the relationship, they bring 50% to the relationship, or you bring 100% to the relationship, they bring 100% to the relationship, okay? Everybody needs to remember that all, not some, all of them, including the relationship you have with your ancestors, God, whoever, your partner, your family, it's 50-50, okay? Whatever you bring to the table, that person also brings to the table. So no one's at fault. Ultimately, no one's at fault because everyone is creating that reality together.
Right.
It takes a narcissist and an empath together to create fuck shit.
True that.
Together. Together. Yeah. Together they create the relationship, not the narcissist just drug the person into a relationship and caught them. Maybe they did, but that person swam right into the net. So there is no, this is going to make people really, really mad when I say this, because they're going to say I'm victim blaming if somebody gets into a relationship and they get hurt. No. You were there for it. Mm-hmm. You saw the warning signs. You saw the bells going off.
Yeah.
At some point in time, your mom or a friend said, are you really sure you want to get up with that person? They should have listened to them.
Right.
So what I'm asking people to do is take 100% responsibility for their part in getting into relationships. Now, if you get into a relationship and they pretended to be one way, and then when you get into the relationship, they flip their switch on you and they turn into somebody else, run, don't stay.
Right.
Well, sometimes you have to be burned or hurt many, many times before you develop the proper boundaries between you and other people. And I hate to tell you, it is about boundaries. It is boundaries.
It is.
Even in a relationship with someone you love, there has to be boundaries.
Yeah, I think my problem is that I didn't set enough boundaries. I think that was my problem. I didn't set enough boundaries, and I don't mean just within my relationship, but with everybody I met. I mean, you saw how I was easily, basically like energetically suppressed whenever anybody would jump up in my life. I would always be like, or dissociate, you know? I would just dissociate from the situation, whatever was going down in my own life. And I'm just like, after all that, and now where I am, that'll never happen again. I'm never gonna have somebody come up and monopolize, you know, my life, you know? If I'm live for a specific reason, I'm gonna hold true to that reason, you know, whether if it's a spiritual panel, or maybe people just want to have a powwow or whatever, or maybe do duo readings, or just talk about spirituality in general, or talk about, you know, the religion, you know, just something, you know. And
yeah, but you know what? You need to, can I give you, as a friend, as a loving friend, a suggestion? I need you to take a step back, because there's only 10 people in here, but 100 people watching on the outside. I need you to take a step back, and I need you to journal about this. I need you to take a blank piece of paper, and I need you to write down at the top, why do I feel the need to help other people? Why do I feel the need to save other people? Why do I feel like I have to be the one to be the bridge or the umbrella or the hot air balloon? Why? I need you to take a step back, because I think that, my love, might be a very, very, very big impediment to your own spiritual progress and elevation. And I'm going to tell you what, I love everybody. I care about everybody, even people I don't like, I would still help them.
Right.
But I have to love myself more.
You're right.
I have to take care of myself more. I have to get me from this side of the shore to the other side of the shore. But I'm not going to get to the other side of the shore when I've got people hanging off the back of my motherfucking boat. That I'm dragging, or how about this? I've thrown in a net and I'm forcing to the other side. You got to remember, you can't drag anyone to the other side of the shore.
Right.
So Derek, I need you to sit back and I need you to reflect on why you feel like you have to be that guy. Because there's a lot of people out there that could do that. I'm going to leave it with you to meditate on.
Well, like I said before, is like spirit literally brings it to my lap. You know, I mean, you had come in whenever I was doing readings that one day, and then it started a whole panel of all these people coming in. We had 300-500 people up in that live that day. You know, we were live for like several hours. People were making videos left and right, talking about how they didn't get a chance to speak their piece or anything like that. We were live for like 6.5, 7
hours. We were live for 8 hours.
8 hours, right?
No, 6 hours. At the 4.5 hour mark, that person was still talking.
Right.
Okay.
Oh, I don't even mean that one. I don't even mean that. Not the second one. That's the second time. I mean the first time. The first time, right? That was a whole riot, my friend. That was a riot.
And here's the thing. I don't have any interest in participating in that anymore. That's the thing. I don't have an interest in participating in that because the conversation in those chats and those discussions are secular. They start here and they end up in the same place they start. That's insanity.
Yeah.
So that's why I'm saying you're not here to play the circus ringleader. Thank you so much. You don't have to be the ringleader. You don't have to be ringleader of the Barnum and Bailey Circus.
I'd just rather, you know, retire at a nursing facility or something and just like maybe go to a rehab for men.
Look, you want to come hang out at a rehabilitation for men and get some sexual healing? I've got the place for you. I've got a place for everything.
You always know what will cure me. A good dicking.
Ass cures everything. Vitamin A. But yeah, I mean, I had to ask myself the question, why aren't you taking your own advice?
Right.
You already know what the outcome of this situation is going to be. You already know how you're going to behave. It's not like I didn't know how I was going to behave. Vitamin D is good too. Vitamin A, D, and V. Very good for you. Yes. And I had to admit defeat. Oh my God, was that a blow to my ego? Yeah. You know what Jennifer did? I'm going to say this. I love Jennifer. I want you to know this. I want everybody to know this. I love Jennifer Sands with all my heart. She's one of my favorite people on the planet. I will always love her. But I had to admit defeat on myself. And that shit checked my ego and destroyed my... I had a ego death.
Yes.
I had a total ego death.
That's beautiful.
In the context of the relationship.
Right.
And it was my fault.
Right.
I will take 100% responsibility for it. I mean, she was there for it. So that 50-50 thing, 100%, 100% thing still applies. But what I'm saying is that that really changed me. It's been like 6 months worth of work for me, emotionally, mentally, spiritually, physically, to try to figure out why. Because, so that's the thing, you never know until you know. That's the thing that sucks. You don't know until you know. And then when you know, way after the fact, you got to sit and go back and meditate on it and ask yourself the question, what the hell happened? It took me 6 months to literally sit there and wonder, how did that start? What happened? What went south? How did it end? And go back and analyze your process through it. Right. But you don't have a process to go back and analyze until you have the experience.
It's true.
And that's the shit that bites you in the ass. That's the painful part.
Yeah. Well, you can't heal without being damaged.
Right. But if no one gets into a relationship with the intention of it ending.
True. True.
No one gets into a relationship with someone if they don't think there's hope, if they don't think that there's a possibility that this can work.
Yeah.
Nobody goes into any relationship saying, oh, this shit's going to fail. Then why the fuck do it?
Right.
But if you are in a relationship and something happens and it ends and you have to separate from one another and go your separate ways because that's what's best for both of your mental health, you have to go back and analyze. And one of the things that played a major role in it, I'm not trying to talk about my relationship. I'm talking about me. Nothing to do with her. I'm talking about me, my process. I was an alcoholic for 30 years, Derek.
Yeah.
You realize that I drank for 30 fucking years.
Yeah.
And what I found out was when I was a drunk getting in and out of relationships, I would get into relationships. I would have these crazy relationships with these crazy people. I would fall out of the relationship. I'd have some kind, there would be a fallout, and then I would move on. And I'd be like, I don't know how I got into the relationship. I don't know what happened in the relationship. I don't understand why it ended. Mm-hmm. And when you're an alcoholic, your brain doesn't process information the same way other people's does.
Right.
Jennifer was the first relationship I got into sober.
Wow.
I got sober in November 2016 was when I dried out, when I almost died. Like for the second time. And I was by myself.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought after a certain amount of time of sobriety that I had the emotional capacity to be able to handle a relationship. And what I realized was, oh, I was not. Because addiction is real.
Right.
Okay. Because alcoholism is real. It's not a joke. It's not just something in your head.
Right. No, it's a disease.
And it broke my ego.
Yeah.
Destroyed my ego.
I feel that.
And at Jennifer's expense.
Whenever I was about 20, 21, something like that, I started doing drugs. You know, I had did drugs, and I did drugs for like a few years, and it was predominantly crystal or coke was what I was doing. And I remember I went to go live with my dad, and he was buying like 8 balls every week, you know, or something like that. He was just buying them left and right. And we would just split an 8 ball together, just going to town. Well, then my mom had told me that she needed help. And I was like, okay. So I ended up moving in. And I was there for like maybe a few months or something like that. My system was clean, everything like that. No drugs or nothing like that. But I was getting kind of ornery, right? Well, ever since then, I've been clean and sober ever since then. You know, ever since 24, I've been clean and sober. So I've been clean and sober for 11, almost 12 years now. So, you know, I didn't allow it to claim me, you know? And, I mean, there's still some of my vices I have, you know, things that I'm working towards, letting go of, and things that I'm doing in order to stay healthy, you know?
What I realized over this past year was I'm not just addicted to alcohol, I'm addicted to everything. That's what I realized. I realized when I finally came to my, I had some massive spiritual explosions going off in my brain. You know, I had major existential crises, multi-dimensional experiences, and all kinds of shit that has happened over the past year. And what I realized was that I'm addicted to everything. And that is a problem. So what I'm trying to tell you, Derek, and I'm not trying to like make this about me, but my experience is, for me, that there is an underlying problem that's rooted really, really, really deep that I have not even scratched the surface of, that has absolutely nothing to do with alcohol.
My sixth, I think it was my fifth or my sixth session, we got to the root of that one. My therapist and I, we got to the root of that. And it was due to abandonment issues that I was suffering from. Whenever I was 5 or 6 years old, my parents had got into a real bad squabble. My stepdad had ended up cheating on my mom. And then she left us, the kids, and with our stepdad. So I suffered from a lot of that abandonment from her because, you know, she was my mom, you know. So it caused me to feel like serious abandonment issues, of course, you know, but it got me to the point to where I couldn't trust somebody, you know. I got to the point where I felt like as if, oh, just somebody, anybody that I love, they will leave me, they will abandon me, and they'll go off and live their life and totally forget all about me. You know, if I gave them half a chance to meet somebody else, they would leave me. So I got angry and I projected and I misplaced and I got heated and I ended up, you know, ruining yet another relationship, you know. But I had to, as I see it, I had to go through that in order to get to where I am now, because now I have the force, I have the understanding, I have the understanding to understand what was going on and why I did the way I did, why I was the way I was. So now I can actually gain control. That gave me power over that when it came to that situation, or when it comes to my, you know, my love life or my family life, my home life, my career, my spirituality.
Well, I mean, I was set up to fail from the jump when it came to relationships. I was set up to fail from birth in relationships. I mean, I had sexual orientation dysphoria for the first 30 years of my, 28 years of my life. Right. For the first 28 to 30 years of my life, I couldn't figure out my own sexual orientation. Okay. Like, seriously. I finally figured it out. But that's a pretty long time to deal with like really aggressive and depressive and manic, dysphoria. That's one thing. And then number two, like my mother and my aunt were just horrible. I just they screwed me over from being able to create deep and meaningful romantic and intimate relationships with women.
Right.
I'm just gonna say it. Y'all wanna know what's wrong with me? I'll tell you right now. My mother and my aunt set me up for failure in every relationship that I was ever gonna have with a female partner ever.
Right.
And that shit didn't hit until I was sober and trying to be in that kind of relationship again. What I realized was that every single trigger that could be pulled, okay, in the arsenal of emotional and mental behavioral health issues was being triggered.
Yeah.
And what happens is that when I'm triggered, I have to remove myself from what's triggering me.
Right.
So in order for me not to snap and not to drink or not to freak out and not end up in the hospital, I have to separate myself from the thing that is triggering me.
Right. In order to overcome that situation, you need to separate yourself so you can decompress.
Yeah.
And yeah, I mean,
just to think straight.
Yeah. Just to think straight, just so you can sort through all the chaos that's running through your head. I feel that 100%. I couldn't decompress in Cali. I couldn't. It was impossible, you know? And I mean, I have nothing but love, right? Like, God, my heart is just, you know, I wish I could go back in time, you know, and save myself from doing, or at least being in that spot. You know what I mean?
It was unavoidable, because I'm going to tell you what, sweetheart, you're ready for this one. If it wasn't him, it would have been somebody else. It would have been somebody. Somebody would have gotten that. Someone.
I don't regret my relationship with him. You know.
I know that, but I'm talking about you.
Right.
At some point in time, that was going to happen to you.
Right.
With whoever it was you were with. And guess what? Jennifer Witchfoot, that what happened between me and her on my end would have happened with any woman I would have gotten with. Yeah. Not just her.
Right.
She's not unique.
Right.
My issues, my emotional and behavioral health problems, my alcoholism and addiction, really, that shit was going to come out in any relationship.
Dang. We've just been in the same damn boat in every life, haven't we?
Okay. That's why I'm saying I take responsibility for my actions. Right. But what I'm saying is like that, all of those meltdowns and shit that I was having, that was going to come up and come out.
Yeah.
Same thing with you. So it's unfortunate that our exes had to be the people to go through that.
Right.
But we can all come out on the other end better.
True. True. Very true.
Thanks for the heart. Yeah. So, I mean, I think that there's no reason to go back and be upset. No one needs to be upset. Everybody just needs to accept that
this is
what happened, and we move on.
I wish I could, like, time travel and then, like, tell myself, hey, come with me. We're gonna go decompress. Let's go fuck some shit up outside or whatever, or go ground or go do something, you know, just to clear our head, you know, and understand what's going on, because everything was happening so fast, right? I mean, every month I'd probably make like $2,500 every month I was there. But towards like the last week, and I mean like the 11th hour, 59th minute, 59th second, it was like I had to hit it hard in order to make the rent. You know what I'm saying? So it was too much on my shoulders, you know? And he ended up leaving his job, which put a lot more on me. And I was just like, son of a biscuit eater, you know, like I started like hyperventilating at that point, you know, I couldn't even function. And it got me to the point where I got manic and depressant, and then I got feral. And when I get feral, everybody just leave me alone. Just go away. Let me go out into the woods so I can go be the feral little creature that I'm supposed to be, you know? And once I did get back into the woods in Texas, everything cleared away. It was just like out of mind. And I finally was able to decompress and then come to an understanding after therapy, what was going on, why I felt the way I felt, why I reacted the way I did, you know?
Yeah, and it feels good when you figure that out. One of the things that really came out for me, I didn't realize this, but I have some kind of adult autism. I'm on some kind of spectrum. I have 100%, I'm on some kind of, I don't know. I think I've always been this way. You know, we didn't talk about Asperger's and ADHD and adult ADHD and neurodivergence in the 80s or the 90s or the early 2000s. Okay. No one was diagnosed with that when we were kids. But whatever's wrong with me, and I say wrong with me because it impedes the quality of my life. I've always been that way. And it's very difficult to live with me. It's very difficult to be around me. I'm a very difficult person to be around. I just am. I'm very difficult to, I'm almost impossible to live with. I am impossible to live with. And it's because I am incredibly sensitive to sound. I'm incredibly sensitive to light. I am incredibly sensitive to overstimulating activities or lots of people being around at one time. Yeah. I have to have the things that I need to function, and I have to have a routine. You see what I'm saying? Hey, Spirit yeah. Witch, good to see you. And if I don't have those things, I melt down.
Me too.
I can no longer control my environment. And when I feel like my environment is getting out of control, I'm getting out of control.
Yep. Yep. We're like two peas in a pod.
I mean, literally, when I say that when you walk into my apartment, my condo, if you walked into my condo, you would probably think that it's silent. Because I'm going to have my yoga music playing at the very, very lowest decibel, but I'll hear it. You might think that you can sit around in a room with your lights on for 4, 5, 6 hours. I have blackout eye masks that I put over my eyes to cut all the light out because I can't handle the light. I live like a vampire in the dark. So, and I have to have that level of quiet and darkness in order to keep what I am under control.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I swear to God that it's absolutely incontrollable, out of my control. It's yeah. totally out of my control. Alcohol and alcoholism fixed that. Mm-hmm. Fixed that. It made me more tolerant. It made me numb so that the sound wasn't so loud and the lights weren't that bright and the sensation on my skin or how I felt was more dull, numbed, or medicated.
Right.
Take the alcohol away. That, Derek, I don't know what happened. After I quit drinking, I no longer could handle sound. I could no longer handle light. I could no longer handle crowds. I couldn't handle anything. I literally felt like what it would be like if you pulled a nerve out of your body and just strummed it.
Wow. Oh yeah, that's, I feel that. I feel that. Yeah.
And it really severely impacts the quality of my life. Right. It does. You know, I can't go places that I want to go because I can't tolerate it.
Yeah. Having epilepsy, I get migraines all the time. Right. So I'm always sitting in the dark because it can come out of nowhere. These migraines can happen out of nowhere. So, I will usually keep all the lights off, right? That's why I got the little candles, because candlelight isn't so bad, you know. It's natural light, you know. So I like it, and it's not too hard on my eyes. And whenever I wake up, you know, I'm able to see where I'm going, but it's not so bright that it's hurting me, you know. It's like somebody's probing my brain from the front of my face.
But for me, it's physically painful. This is what I need people to understand. I'm not minorly irritated. I'm not like, I don't get just a little irritable. It's no, it painful hurts. To my ears. It hurts my eyes physically. Yeah. So one night me and Grant went out for Thai food, and the Thai food place opened like at 5. So we come waltzing in at 5. We're the only people there. We sit down. I feel good. I feel fine. We order our soup. We order whatever. And over the next 45 minutes, as we're waiting for our food and they're bringing food out and more people start coming in, people are talking. More people are coming in and sitting down and taking off their jackets. And they're talking to the waitress and they're talking with one another. And now the sound volume in the restaurant is getting like what most people would just think is normal. I can't think.
No.
I can't concentrate. And one of the things that destroys me more than anything is the sound of things clanging, like bells or spoons in cups, metal cups, or bells, or the sound of glasses banging up against each other and silverware wrestling. That for me is like, oh my God. And it's painful. It hurt. And then I get into this place where I'm not functioning and I literally can't think. I went with my friend Leah and Jessica. We went to a donut shop or someplace where we bought a pastry shop that was very famous in Massachusetts. Place was crowded. Kids running back and forth and screaming, and I'm standing in there like I had this look on my face. And Leah came up to me and said, are you okay in here? Because you don't look like you're okay in here. Because she can read me. And I'm like, I'm okay. I'll be okay. And she was like, are you really okay? I said, with my mental and behavioral health problems, this environment is very bad for me, and I'm not able to concentrate. Like, I literally lose the ability to think. People might think, oh, this guy's crazy. He's just talking shit. I guarantee you 100%. That's a real phenomena that happens with me.
It's like you start dissociating almost.
I disassociate. I couldn't work at Starbucks.
Yeah, no.
I couldn't be a barista. I don't have the capability to be a barista.
Yeah. That was always my problem, is that I focus in too much on everything that I hear and see. And not to mention being an empath, being psychic, being intuitive, that's even harder in public where there's hundreds of people every day coming in, coming out, you know, and they're bringing in all their spirits as well. No.
Well, that's the other thing. The other thing is that I'm also a psychic medium, so I'm not just picking up on these people. I'm picking up on every single person's energy field, what they're bringing in with them, their moods, because I'm not just an empath. I'm like uber empath. You know, you and I are both super psychics, right? So Spirit Witch is super psychic.
Yeah.
I almost feel like I get lost in a sea of conscious energy. I'm in a crowded place,
it makes me feel like as if I'm literally drowning. And even if I'm trying to hold my breath, it feels like as if water rushes into my nose and goes down my throat. Like, and then it feels like as if my ears build up and it's like the pressure gets so much that I feel like my head's gonna explode, right? And then I get pissed. I get really pissed. Very pissed.
Because your fuse is done.
Yeah.
You've had enough.
I'm done at that point. I'm like, all right, the tiger needs to go back in his cage. You know, the wolf needs to go back to the woods.
Well, I mean, that's the whole thing with me. Like, the thing with me is I require a lot of time by myself and alone, where I am alone and I'm not interacting with another person or several people. And that means that I have to live alone. I have to live alone. I can't live with another person. I'm not capable of living with another person. I have to live alone just to keep my crazy under control.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I don't even have the words, because normal people, what I had to realize, Derek, was that people don't feel the way I feel. Like, I always ask myself the question, I don't understand why these people are doing that. How can they do that? Because they don't experience the world the way that I do.
No. Everybody's brains are wired completely differently. You know, I walked 10 miles home in the snow from a party because I was sensory overload. Yeah, I would have
done that. I mean, for me, my eyes will start to squint. And they'll get more and more and more and more squinty and more and more. And my eyes will get more and more and more and more and more closed the longer I'm exposed to light.
Right. Right.
And I have to take breaks.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. Oh. My gosh. Let's see. What is this? This is still November, huh?
Thyroid. What does that mean, thyroid? What does thyroid have to do with anything, mama?
Maybe hormonal imbalance?
Oh, no. I don't have a hormonal imbalance. I am full of testosterone.
He really is.
Yeah.
A lot of testosterone in his system.
Yeah, well, I suffer from severe mental and behavioral health problems that comes from a neglectful childhood and sexual abuse, and then 30 years of alcoholism on top of that. That is what you're dealing with when you get into a relationship with me, or when you're interacting with me. You're interacting with someone who is not functional like a normal person can function in the regular world. You guys see me here when I go live for a couple hours, or you guys watch my TikToks, or you follow me on different social media and you see me posting things. I'm all by my motherfucking self doing all of those things. And the reason why I am a massage person, or I do male for male massage, is because I get to interact with one person at a time in a peaceful, quiet environment that I have control over. There you go. That's everything you need to know about me.
I think out of everybody here on this platform on TikTok, I think you are probably the only person who could come close to understanding me. The only person. Seriously. Even if somebody lived with me for years, it wouldn't matter. Like, I feel like sometimes you understand me better than my own mother. Actually, she might even agree. She would probably agree with you. She'd probably agree with that. She'd be like, oh yeah, yeah. You probably do know him better than me. She would.
I mean, I think my biggest eye-opening experience over the past 2 years, we'll just put it the 2 years, past 2 years, I'm getting on TikTok.
Right.
Really revealed to me all of the areas that I needed to grow and all of the areas that I was really sick. Yeah. TikTok was the beginning of it. TikTok was just the beginning of it, the social experiment, right?
Right.
TikTok will bring the worst out in everyone. It will. It will bring the worst out in you. This app should not be called TikTok. It should be called the shadow work app, because eventually you will get triggered enough and that shadow will start coming out. And I see it come out in everyone. Wow. I saw it came out in me. I've seen it come out in some of these other people on here. And I'm just like,
you've seen it come out of me.
Damn. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, Spirit Witch, you're right. The algorithm does cause it.
Spirit Witch, I have nerve damage in my spine. And that nerve damage, oh man, that chronic pain, I feel you. It, and I'll tell you what, it is really, really difficult to wake up in the morning and start your day and have a smile on your face and be nice to people and appear to be happy when you're in pain. I deal with chronic pain in my, all of my joints, especially my knees, hips, lower back, my neck, my elbows, my shoulders, and my wrist. I'm serious injuries, and a lot of nerve damage. And so I'm in pain a lot. I'm in pain most of the time, unless I'm doing something and I'm distracted. I'm not thinking about the pain, but I'm still in pain because I'll be doing whatever it is I'm doing. I'll be like, God damn it, I'm in pain right now, but I'll keep doing it anyway. That also wears you down, eventually.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I have to go to a chiropractor to get like my spine realigned. Because I didn't realize it, but apparently I have like a bulging disc thing happening somewhere close towards my lumbar. And so I'm like, I'm so skittish about that though. Like, especially if they like put their arms around my neck, I'm like, please don't mess with my neck. Just from my shoulders down, you're great. My neck just naturally, it stretches and naturally pops. I'm not cranking my neck, you know?
Well, the thing about me is I literally have to do yoga for myself every single day. I have to do 15 or 20 minutes worth of yoga every single day. And I do it before I go to bed. I mean, I don't care if it's 3 o'clock in the morning. Mm-hmm. I will still do 15 or 20 minutes worth of yoga before going to sleep, because if I don't, I can't walk.
I've gotten back into Tai Chi.
Good for you.
I have. I've been doing it for at least 45 minutes a day now. I started off at 15, and that was hard. But then I ended up building it up over the past few months, and now I'm at 45 minutes, and I can actually hold... I can actually hold my stances smoother, but a lot stronger, smoother, and slow. Like, I have so much more control. And that was something that I have always struggled with in the past. You know, it's been always a serious struggle for me to actually maintain focus on my energy and controlling which way it's going, how it's flowing. And I mean, it's just been repetitive. And I even go on Google and I will look up like Tai Chi guidance from a Tai Chi master, you know, and I would just follow along with them.
Yeah. So I did something. I signed up for Capoeira class. I wanted to take a Capoeira class. I don't know if you know what that is. It's the martial arts. It comes from Brazil. It's Afro-Brazilian. Mm-hmm. You kick, you spin around and stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
So much fun. I took like two classes and then I was like, I can't take these classes. I signed up for a membership and then I told the guy, I'm sorry, I have to cancel my membership because literally I could not do the movement. It was destroying my back because you're always going like this. You're going always like that. You're bending forward.
And your foot is like crossing like this.
Yeah, it's like dancing. It is like dancing. It's like a dance. But it's but you're also constantly bending forward. And I can't bend forward like that all the time with my lower back. And I was so sad because I wanted to take those classes. And I'm like, no, I need to be doing Pilates. I need to be doing yoga. Like, I need to be doing stretches and stuff that doesn't require me to like jump up and down. Like, I can't even like jump up and down. And I'm like, God damn, I'm like 43 years old. Capoeira is spelled C-A-P-O-R-I-A, I think. But yeah, I couldn't do it. I wanted to, but it was just too much.
I don't know, the second that, the only part I can do is just, or the stepping, that's it. That's all I can do. I cannot go to like a full on like crazy spin kick thing.
Well, yeah. So the thing is like they were doing all that stuff. He was teaching like how to like step, kick, kick over, bend over, and then he would put you in front of somebody and that person and you would spar with one another or play where you like are kicking at each other.
You're just missing each other. Yeah.
And I was like, I don't, my body doesn't have the endurance level, because they would do these like 5 minute drills where you would just basically be going with this person for like 5 minutes. I couldn't do it. I couldn't keep up with it.
No,
no. Because after 2 minutes, I was like, I got to take a break. And I was so upset because I was so active my whole life.
Yeah.
I was a modern dancer.
Yeah.
I danced. And now when I look at videos of myself, and if anybody ever wants to see me dance, you can go to my YouTube channel. I got a whole playlist. I got a whole 20 years, actually almost 30 years worth of dance career right there for you to watch on YouTube. I can't believe that I can't fucking bend over now or handle kicking my leg.
Yeah, no, I feel that. I used to be able to pick up a transmission clean off of the ground, and now I can barely lift up 100 pounds, you know, I feel the struggle to lift 100 pounds, you know, whereas before 100 pounds was nothing. I could just pick it up with my pinky or something, you know, and just toss it. It was nothing for me back when, you know, I was like a little demigod running around on this flat earth.
My stamina used to be, I used to have the stamina of an Olympic athlete. I used to have that stamina. I mean, I used to be able to do very intense, active, high impact contact partner work modern dance on pieces that were literally like up to 25 to 30 minutes long. I'm talking a continuous piece that continued to go for 25 minutes, 35 minutes was the longest work I ever did. I'm talking continual dancing with breaks, but like a whole half an hour set. I don't know how the fuck I ever did that.
Right. Must have been because
been because I was 20.
That's it. That's the secret. You were 20. You were still basically a fetus with all the energy in the world, you know. There was nothing to stop you. You were immortal and your body was that of an Adonis god, right?
Let me tell you something. One time I was in my bedroom. I'm in my kitchen right now. My bedroom is like over there, like way over there. And I'm just going to pretend that like way over there is my bathroom. I was in my bedroom. The bathroom was like way over there. It's about, say, 12 feet. Yeah, we'll say 10 feet, 10 to 12 feet. 12 feet, you would be inside my bathroom, okay? There's a point, there's a moral to this story. Actually, this is a totally immoral story, but I want to tell it anyway. I'm on my bed, right? And I'm like,
right,
driving the car, okay? So I'm doing my thing, right? And then explosion, you know, have my spiritual experience, right?
Right.
I got up and walked into the bathroom and my load was in the bathroom, like in the other room. And I was like, what is that? And I was like, no, that is absolutely not okay. And I was like, oh my God, damn. Like, wow. That don't happen anymore. I'd be lucky if I shot past my belly button.
I feel that. Me too. No, no bars, no caps.
Man, I hate this place. Oh boy, I just felt like sharing that with y'all. Yeah, and that's like, man, I tell you what. Vigor is wasted on the youth. Because when you're a guy, I'm going to tell you what. When you're a guy and you hit 40, ooh, that... I'm not even going to lie to you. There's a reason it's called over the hill. The over the hill part is your sex drive goes down. Down.
Yeah.
And you start burning out and you start feeling the burnout. It's just interesting. It's biology. It happens. It happens to every man. As he gets older, the sex drive goes, the testosterone levels start to drop, you know, you're not producing as much, you know,
right.
As you used to. And, I had some kid checked my ego. The second time I had an ego death this year is because I still put out stuff. I still put out things, pictures, videos and stuff.
Right.
And I had somebody, I had some kid private message me that said, wow, you're just like not as energetic as you used to be. Oh. Oh my God. Started
flapping like a fish out of water.
My face was like, and then I was like, I need to go process this experience and feel what I need to feel and mourn and grieve my youth and my virility. And then sit and think about, and then meditate on how I'm okay with getting older and rationalizing biology and like all of the million things going through my head. Because this not teenage boy, he wasn't a teenage boy. He was like in his 20s or whatever. But he was like, oh, I really miss your, it was like, basically what he said is you're old. Basically what he said is, wow, you've gotten old. Oh man, that was like, that killed my motherfucking ego so hardcore. Man.
I'd been like, if it was me, I'd been like, teach me. You know, I would have been like, teach me.
Well, I responded with, well, buddy, you know, I'm 42 years old and I'm just not as energetic as I used to be. And then he was like, oh, no, I didn't mean that you're old. I just like a lot of your old videos, you know, when you were really like, and then he was just like, then he just was embarrassed. And I'm like, you don't have to be embarrassed. I'm old. I'm old. I'm an old man.
You're not old.
In Pajoran world, I am. Well, actually, not really, because these days, anybody at any age can do anything that they want, and they can still make money doing it. And that's
right.
Yeah.
That's right. 100. See, you already know.
I'm going to go get some fucking Viagra right now.
Go for it, baby. You get it.
No, we ain't doing all that. We ain't doing extras, okay? No extras.
I love it.
Spirit witch. That's hysterical. What water is that? geriatric.
That's horrible.
Wow, Mystic Mom.
Damn.
That's okay. I like daddies too. I like older men. I'm not gonna lie. I matter of fact, I like older women too. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, most of the people I've been with in my entire life have always been older than me.
Miss B's all like Derek's face. When I read Mystic Mom's comment, yeah. I was like, that's cool though, you know?
Yeah, I'm still up. I've been up till like 2-3 o'clock in the morning every single night. And I've been sleeping till like 10. I've been having a lot of, my brain is like resetting itself. And part of resetting itself is like not being able to maintain a schedule. Like I literally have to, just allow my body to do what it's going to do naturally. And if it wants to be up, it's just going to be up until it has to go to sleep. And then I'll pass out.
I feel that.
You're hysterical.
Her?
Mm-hmm. She's yeah. Hysterical.
She is. I love it.
I mean,
I'm wasting time if I sleep. I can go days. I feel that.
I don't. I feel like I could sleep at any point in time, and I could sleep as I could just sleep. I could sleep the rest of my life away. I'd be fine with that. I would.
Cuddles.
I mean, I am totally emotionally invested in the afterlife.
Say.
I'm really emotionally invested now in the afterlife as a spiritualist, as a medium, as someone who has gotten to the practices that I'm practicing. I have more emotional investment in death than I do being alive. Not that I want to die. I don't want to die. I mean, I want to be alive. But like, I really want to know what happens. Like, I'm here for it.
I mean, I've died 5 times, but I haven't like stayed dead, you know? I remember seeing a spirit. I think it was one of my guides. And they were like, what are you doing here? And then I remember waking up.
Go ghost investigating.
Go ghost.
Spirit witch, I'm sorry for all of everything that's been going on. I know that you have had loss, and I'm so sorry about it. But there's this Taoist wizard that I saw, martial artist, Qigong master, whatever. And he was talking about how when you die or when the spirit leaves the body, okay, that you are more potent and powerful than when you're physically embodied.
Yes.
So like when your loved one passes, and the energy consciousness, okay, leaves the body, that is so much more powerful and intact than the physical body, because we grow out of this world in the same way apples grow out of apple trees. Right. We are produced from the earth, and then we are liberated by spirit. We grow out of this universe. We grow out of this world.
Right.
So our consciousness is born and manifest and transcends. So sometimes they go away and they'll come back, like Jennifer's grandmother came back, like, I don't know, like 30 years later she showed up, you know. So
yeah, I've had my cousin and my stepdad's father come to me. And my stepdad's father told me I needed to start taking my medicine. And this was like 5 years back. And my cousin told me that I don't need to be sad about her passing. and that she didn't want me there because she wanted me to maintain the memory of her being strong and beautiful and vivacious, you know. So she didn't want my image of her, her strength and her personality to be diminished, you know. She wanted me to hold on to that strong, that strength of her. So I never got to go to the funeral or nothing like that. So, but as a medium, I mean, I still got to say my goodbyes.
God, you just said something and you made me want to, you triggered something, a memory or something I wanted to say. You were talking about, oh, I remember, about people wanting you to remember them the way they were prior to getting old, prior to getting sick and all of that. Okay. Sometimes I wonder, like Chadwick Boseman, I know this is stupid. I know I'm talking about like a movie star, but I'm thinking about like Marilyn Monroe, Elvis Presley, River Phoenix, Chadwick Boseman. You look at some of these talented, Heath Ledger. You look at some of these talents that there's so much talent, they almost can't contain the talent. And I wonder, did the ancestors take Chadwick Boseman because they needed to have a Black Panther that would always be the Black Panther forever? Because Chadwick Boseman will always be the Black Panther. And everyone that follows behind him to take that role will always take a second step behind that man and his greatness and his power, his image, okay? And I'm thinking, why did the ancestors take him? Why did they take him? Because they needed to have a hero eternally. He will be a hero eternally.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Without any mistakes, without any flaws. Mm-hmm. A flawless hero.
That's what my cousin wanted. She wanted us to maintain that idea, to always have that strong, beautiful, intelligent, vivacious, driven woman who could do anything she set her mind to, and nothing was ever gonna hold her back, you know. And whenever she passed, I want to say it was a couple years later, she ended up coming to me, and I was actually in my mom's room, and I was talking to my mom, and all of a sudden I felt her first, and then I started to see her, and I was just like, I told my mom, Mom, she goes, yeah. And I go, Cassie's here right now. And she goes, I feel her. And I was like, and I basically told her the same thing that I just told you, that she didn't want the memory of her diminished.
I mean, the universe only has a certain amount of like what? Particles and molecules to go around to keep people alive and to keep things embodied. I mean, think about it. Like the reason why you have to die is because somebody else has to get their turn. Okay. Like you can't be here. Like we need like more bodies. We need more things. I feel like this is how I feel. So the name that I use, or the word that I use, the title I use to refer to Almighty God is Oludamare. I have settled on Oludamare as the name of God for me. The meaning of the word is what gets me. It's not necessarily the way it sounds. The meaning of the name Oludamare means the owner of all possible outcomes. It also means the owner of the pot that's never exhausted. And when you think about the universe and you think about pots, what in the universe resembles a pot if it's not the supermassive black hole that sits at the center of our galaxy, at the galactic center? Oludamare owns that. and is the owner of all possible outcomes, meaning everything happens for a reason and it's directed. Because people, don't be so arrogant as to believe that you're making all of the choices in your life.
Facts. For us to think we have free will.
How dare you be so arrogant as to think that all the choices you make are yours?
Right. That's cute. They just look down and they're just like...
Well, I mean, yeah. They're like, yeah. And when you... If you're really a spiritualist... And you really believe in spirits, angels, demons, gods, goddesses, orishas, lawa, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter what you call them, okay, in what culture. If you believe in spirits, then you have to believe that, bitch, you're not the only person driving the wheel.
Right. Facts. That is so true. That is so true.
Yeah. So when you realize that, then you sit down and you shut the F up.
Yeah.
For a minute. Psychotic breaks are very good at making you do that too. Sitting down and shutting up.
Right. Right. But you know what? That's how you learn. You know? I mean, there's a reason why we got two ears and one mouth. You know? We're supposed to listen twice as much as we speak.
Well, I mean, if I had two mouths, there would be a dick in both. So, you know what? Like I said before, and this is a truth, you don't know until you know. You don't know until you know. And then once you know, then you have to go back and try to figure out why that happened. You know what I'm saying? Elon Musk is such a motherfucking brilliant man. I know people hate Elon Musk. I think he's a tortured soul. He's got a lot of problems. He's got a lot of spirits around him, okay? I don't know if you can see him, but I can see him.
You know what? I was going to ask you about that the other day. I was like...
Oh, I can see him.
Yeah, because, like, there's... Okay, like, when I look at him, there's one, like, directly behind his left shoulder. It's really dark. And I see it on him all the time.
He needs to be cleaned off. And I mean, like with Palo or like with voodoo, he needs to be cleaned off. He's got a lot of negative energy on him. A lot of that negative energy is stuff people are throwing at him. Just the energy he's getting by being. Now, here's the thing. Even if you don't like Elon Musk, you have to agree that he's one of the people that is shaping the entire dialogue of the entire world. You have to be able to take a step back, even if you don't like him, and listen to what he's saying, because I'm going to tell you something else about that guy. If anybody in the world knows what's going on in the world, it's going to be him. Sure. And it's going to be these other people that rule this place. So... One thing he said in an interview with Lex Fridman, I recommend you go to YouTube, look up interview with Elon Musk and Lex Fridman. Watch that interview, because he's talking about consciousness and he's talking about the universe. And it's Elon Musk's opinion that either everything is conscious or nothing is conscious.
And you said Lex Fridman?
Lex Fridman, yeah. Everything is conscious. We live in a conscious universe. Everything is conscious.
Yes.
Consciousness is the foundation of reality.
Yeah.
And then he was talking about, like, Lex Fridman was like, so are we running in a simulation or what? Is this a simulation? And are we just part of a simulation? Simulation theory. And Elon Musk said, well, let's just say there are entities, gods or whatever you want to call them, that created this simulation, started the ball rolling, and take a step back to see what would happen. If they knew what was going to happen, why would they run the simulation? The only reason why you run a simulation is because you want to find out what happens.
Right. I mean, what else is a physical experience for a spirit other than just an experience?
There's something about the way we experience time that the spirit world does not experience.
Oh yeah, it's way
being different. In a physical body and being in three-dimensional space really warps our ability to see.
Did I tell you about the time that I was in like a 3-day coma?
No.
I literally, oh my God. I was like 19 and I was with the first, like my first actual, like out in the open boyfriend, you know, as an adult. And I was just so happy, right? And after like about a year of us being together, or a year and a half of us being together, his parents were just like, either you leave with him and never come back, or he goes and y'all aren't together anymore. And I was like, it's kind of messed up that you're giving your own son an ultimatum. I'm not gonna stoop to that low of a level. So I'm ending the relationship. And I ended up not sleeping or eating for a solid week. For a solid week, all I did was smoke cigarettes and drink Dr. Pepper and play Guitar Hero 2. That was it. That's all I did for a solid week. And my mom was getting so concerned. She was so worried. So she ended up reaching out to my boyfriend at that time, called him, got him to talk to me, to tell me that I need to eat and that I need to go to sleep and I need to hydrate and everything like that. So that a way he can come pick me up that following weekend, and that a way I would live, you know, live long enough to see him again. And so I did. And whenever I passed out, I was out for 3 days. I didn't move, not once. The way on how I laid down is exactly the same way I woke up. But here's the thing. It felt like centuries there. It felt like centuries passed for me. I felt like as if, and not to mention all of the entities I met while I was there. And it's not something that you could just fabricate with your mind. Like, these were very specific, down to the follicle, like the hair on their chin, or the freaking light that was coming up out of their skin, or the crystals that you could see that was emanating an energy, or the whole different realm, or seeing a big ass giant space whale fly through the freaking sky. I mean,
it's so funny that you're saying this right now, because I had an experience like that, but as a kid.
Okay.
An experience as a kid like that. I was, I don't know if I was sick or not sick at the time, but I was at my grandmother's house, and I was on her couch wrapped up in all these blankets and pillows, and I fell asleep and I had a dream. And in that dream, I felt like that dream went on for years, years, years. Like, I was gone for years. Yeah. And then I snapped back, and when I woke up, I was still like 10 years old. Yeah. It was so crazy. It was like I was gone for years.
For me, I didn't age. It was much more like, for mentally. Some reason, I had astral projected outside of myself. And I was in the astral, and I was gone, and I went to an ethereal realm where everything was just like, it was like a hub center. It made me feel like as if I was going to a spiritual hub where all the spiritual guides all come together and collect their assignments, and then they go out.
You're in the Gap Junction, Marvel Universe.
Right. And this is so crazy, because it was like a big old giant building behind a giant door. And this door had like stones all over it. And I ended up pushing it open. And whenever you open it up, I walk through and I mean, you look up and I mean, it goes up like maybe 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, about maybe 20, 30, 30 stories at least. But it's so big, it made it look like, it made a blue whale look like a fish swimming in a pond. Like that's how big of an area it was. And you could just see all of these beings just walking around and everything like that. It was too specific for it to have been something like my mind doing something. You know what I'm saying? So
you definitely had a transcendental experience for sure. I mean, you definitely went out into the app. So here's the thing, everybody, just for terminology purposes, I call everything the quantum field now. The quantum field, everything exists in the quantum field. And so like what people call the astral, what people call the Akashic record, what people say the realm of the fairy, what people say heaven, the realm of the ancestors, to me, all of those existences exist within the quantum field. They all exist somewhere in the quantum field, and we all live in the quantum field. So taking that journey in the quantum realm, you were quantum. You went totally full on quantum.
I was there for about 268 years, give or take a couple decades.
When I came back from that, it's not like sleeping. It's like literally you die. It's almost like death.
Yeah.
And but when I snapped back to my body and woke up, it was almost like I remember the feeling of like, I haven't been here for a long time. And I remember thinking to myself, oh my God, I'm a kid again. Mm-hmm. It was so weird.
Maybe
it's why we're the way we are. Maybe we were kidnapped by aliens or something.
That's what it was. I think so. I wouldn't doubt it, honestly, because I woke up and my family wasn't even there when I woke up. Like I went looking for them after I actually woke up, and I ended up calling them and I was all like, hey, and they're like, oh my God, you're alive, right? And I was all like, yeah. They're like, I go, where are y'all at? And they're like, well, we went to go pick up your brother, you know, to bring him over here because, you know, we're getting kind of worried about you. And, you know, we checked to see on you. You were breathing. Your heart was beating. Everything was fine. It was just, you would not move. You wouldn't wake up. I tried to wake you up. Nothing.
Yeah, but you know what you experienced and whatever I experienced, which might or might have been this, might or might not have been the same phenomenon or something like it. There are people that are magical adepts and meditation masters that can do that, can literally leave their body for days, not eat, not drink, in a state of like suspended animation, asleep. They look like they're dead, but they're not dead. They're asleep. That have gone so far out into the supernatural realm or the quantum field that they're gone. And they're consciously gone. And I'm going to tell everybody a secret, okay? I'm going to tell you an occult secret. This is importante, okay? Dream work is everything.
Yeah.
Dreams are very important. If you want to be more psychic, if you want to be more aware, if you want to get control over your shadow self, if you want to go and meet the ancestors and go meet your guides, your spirits, your orishas, whoever it is, start paying attention to your dreams. Write them down. Keep a dream journal. There are some people in this planet that their entire spiritual practice revolves around dreaming, dream work.
Yeah.
And I'm going to recommend it to you because I've had some really powerful dreams that were not dreams. They were experiences. There's a difference between going to sleep at night and having a dream and going to sleep at night and having a full on experience, like you're walking through another world. And I have had those experiences a handful of times where I woke up and I said, I was not here, not here. I was gone. I was somewhere else. And, well, that's the thing. Dream work is hard. It's not easy. It's not easy. And it's a gift. Psychic dreaming is a gift. Lucid dreaming is a gift. Not everybody can do it.
Yeah. I can lucid dream, but only whenever I prepare myself for it. Before I lay down, go to sleep, I have to like set that intention that I'm going to be fully aware and I'm going to take control once I get over there. And whenever I do, it's just so that a way me, myself, I'm deciding for that moment that this is what I'm going to do. And if I don't decide that, then my body just goes to sleep and I just dream. And sometimes I don't even remember my dreams, you know, because I'm just sleeping so good. And, but whenever I make it a point that I want to have complete control once I get there, oh, I do. And I will hop on the nearest broomstick and fly my ass to wherever else I want to go, you know? Which is funny because I can only ride a broom with bristles facing forward. I can't face it backwards.
That's interesting.
Isn't that interesting?
I have a very big intention to do a very strong focus on dream work this year. There's a great book, and it's a Buddhist book about dreaming. It's called The Tibetan Yogas of Dream and Sleep. It's written by someone who is a shamanic Buddhist, a Bon Buddhist. I've shared it many, many, many times, but it is, it gives you all of the secrets. It gives you all the secrets to be able to learn how to dream, and train yourself to dream.
Is it a book?
Yeah. It's a book. Yeah. Yeah. Matter of fact, I think I have it right here. I'll show it to you guys. Now here's the thing about me, the techniques that are in his book work. Because they're the techniques, but you can literally replace the symbols or the divinities with Orishas, Lawa, or anything else, because it's a technique. Mm-hmm. Whereas I have like all my, here it is. Yeah, I'm gonna show you guys this book. Hold on, people.
I have really missed you.
I missed you too. It's good to see you. We haven't talked in a while, a minute. But guess what? I haven't talked to anyone. So you're not, I haven't been avoiding you.
I know.
Let me see. Let me do this.
I have been pretty busy though. I've been keeping myself busy.
This is the book, everybody. Sleep. The Tibetan Yogas of Dream and Sleep. By Tenzin Wangyal Rinpoche. This guy, he's written lots of books. Wow. He's actually located in Charlottesville, Virginia. He has an entire center there. Of course, this book isn't super thick. Mm. We're talking about 200 pages. Less than 250 pages. Mm. This is a very good book, and I'm getting ready to read it again because of the fact that I literally need to read this book again. do you know, like, there's some books that you're like, you read it and you're like, oh man, I need to try that, and then you don't do it, and then like 5 years later you're like, shit, I should have done everything that guy said.
Right.
See what I'm saying?
Yeah, I feel that. Yeah, I'm, you know, throughout my whole practice, for me, it was always something that my spirits would tell me to do or almost like as if I was being drawn by my spirit to do something. And then I would end up looking it up. And then I end up finding out what it was. And I never understood why it was that way. And I guess from with it being like that for me and growing up from the time I was like 8 years old all the way up to now, it was always like I would practice before I would find out what it was. And then I would be like studying over what it was after I've practiced it. And it was always backwards for me, you know? And for me, that's hard. I mean, it's such a difficult space because you don't know what resources to give to other people, you know? So I love it whenever there's somebody that shares those resources, shares those books, you know? And it's just like, it helps, you know?
Whatever you said earlier that triggered some kind of thought in me still wants to come up, and it's not, one of my spirits is hounding me on it, and I'm like, oh. It's not dreams. It's not about dreams.
No, it's about what my cousin told me. She wanted the image of her to be preserved.
No, it's not that either.
Huh.
Something magical, something about magic. Mm. My ear is like gone deaf on this side, so I know that's why they're trying to say something. Mm. Like this side is completely deaf now. What are you trying to say? Okay. So let me just give some general advice. General advice, people, pay attention to your body. Pay attention to your body. And I don't mean watch your health. Mindfulness meditation. Take time every hour. Try to every hour, every couple of hours, every single day for a week. If you're slowing down or stopping, right? Or taking a break at work or nothing's going on. Stop, pause, and actually body scan from the crown of the head all the way down to the feet, from the toes all the way up the legs, the back, the abdomen. Slow your breath down and check in with your physical body. Pay attention to the signals your body is giving you, because your body is picking up on stuff all the time that you're not consciously registering.
Right.
If you want to be more psychic, besides paying attention to those dreams, pay attention to how your body feels. Your body is picking up on a lot more than you do. It's like when you walk into a room and as soon as you walk into this room, you get this feeling like, ooh, bad vibes, bad energy. Or you meet somebody, or you're in there standing in the room with someone, and the presence of that person is making your body feel uncomfortable. That's your body being smarter than you. Your body is smarter than you are. Okay? Pay attention to the way your body feels, because you will learn a lot just from listening to your body. Most people, not body aware at all, walking around totally unaware of how their body feels.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. I have been suffering from severe existential crises, panic attacks. Like I said, I've had a really bad mental and emotional health year. It's been very difficult for me to keep reality together for myself, like keep reality glued together. Like literally, I have been like taping my reality together with tape, okay? Keeping it together. What has helped me in moments where I literally felt like I was not going to exist anymore, and I'm not joking, like poof, gone, pay attention to the physical body, be in touch with the physical body, breathe with the body, pay attention to how you feel, and recognize that you're okay. You're just fine.
You know, it's so funny.
You're okay.
You know, it's funny you're saying that, right? Because I've noticed that I've been in almost instinctually doing that, where I'm listening to my body. And I would even procrastinate, even though I know what my body is telling me I need to do. I procrastinate because I'm just a glutton for punishment, I guess. I'm a bit of a I don't know if I'm a masochist, maybe. I don't know.
Maybe.
But I will literally procrastinate, even though whenever my body's screaming at me, like, you need to go take a spiritual bath. You need to go sweep and mop your floors. You need to do a spiritual floor wash. You need to go smoke cleanse. You need to go to the mat, go divinate. You need to do this. You need to do that. Yeah. And that, it's just funny that you're saying that, because that's something I have been doing lately. And I've been noticing some major shifts happening.
Yeah. Like what you just said, what resonates with me is I'll hear that voice in the back of my head that says, go light that incense and clean yourself off with it. I will stop whatever I'm doing and I will go light my incense and I will rogate my head with the incense and clean me up and down, front and back, betwixt the legs and all around, up the crack. And I won't hesitate. Whenever I feel a spiritual urge coming on, a spiritual impulse, or I feel like my spirits are trying to push me to do something, yeah, I do it. If I walk past my ancestor altar and I feel like they need a shot of Florida water, mm-hmm, I'll go grab a shot glass and I'll put some Florida water in it and I'll put it on there. Or if I get this feeling like there's a book that I need to be reading, but I don't know what I need to, I'll open up my Kindle and then I'll sit there and I'll be like, I need to search for something. I need to search for Tibetan Buddhism. I'll type it in and a book will pop up and a title will be there that will basically be hitting on what I'm interested in. It's like getting in touch with the algorithm. It's because the universe runs on an algorithm, everybody. It runs on an algorithm.
It
does. So the more I feel people who are psychic are just more tuned into the algorithm.
Yeah.
That's it. I don't think being a psychic or a medium is something special, like more special than someone else. I just feel like psychic mediums are more in tune with that flow.
Yeah.
And when you have a spiritual impulse to like pull out your tarot cards and shuffle them and find out what the spirit has to say, do it. But don't be obsessed and don't allow it to throw you into some kind of spiritual psychosis, okay? That's you right. Need to be very emotionally detached, yeah, from your practice. Hey, Derek, I'm gonna use a bathroom. Would you go ahead and answer this question down here? Black Wolf Witch asks, how do you figure out your gifts? You could say something about that.
Oh, absolutely.
I'll be right back.
How do you figure out your gifts? So, Black Wolf Witch. Okay. Well, you can figure out your gifts amongst so many ways. You can either get a reading from somebody who is a spiritual gift reader. Okay. Or you could literally just like what he was saying about like listening to your body, right? Listen to sounds that you hear, maybe not with your ears, but maybe even in your head, right? Things that you might see, right? If you're seeing things, that's clairvoyance, right? If you're smelling things, clairolfication. If you're tasting things, clairgustance. Okay, whenever you're sensing things like the energetic shifts, clairsentience, right? Whenever you hear things, clairaudience. Whenever you engage with the dead, that which exists beyond the veil, that's mediumship, right? So if you want to find out what your gifts are, you simply need to put yourself in that state. Right. But this is what I tell my students, right? Don't force it, right? In fact, the harder you try, the harder it is for you to actually receive, right? Because we're so put into that spot where we feel as though we have to project ourselves out there to hear something, right? That's not the case. You don't have to project yourself outside of yourself to hear something. You are a part of everything, just as everything is a part of you. The connections of reality is interwoven to you. As we were talking about an algorithm, the universe runs on an algorithm. Your body, you is attuned to that frequency, to that algorithm. So it all depends on how you are receiving it, right? Are you seeing it more? Are you hearing it more? Are you smelling it more? Are you tasting it more? Are you feeling it more? You know, what are you experiencing? That will lead you to find out exactly what kind of gifts you have.
So I have a mentorship program. I have mentees. Basically, the people pay me to be their personal life coach. I'm more accessible to you than I am to anyone else. I do one reading for you a month, and then you get to hang out and like download my PDFs. But yes, I'm offering that as a service to everyone, just so you know. But I have found that there are five primary disciplines that every witch, spiritualist, medium, practitioner of anything needs to focus on. There's five things, five magical occult arts that everyone should be practicing, and you can practice them all at the same time, and they'll all develop at different rates. The first thing you need to do, Spirit Witch said this, and she's not wrong. The first thing you need to learn is Reiki. You need to understand healing energy and movement of energy. We're talking Tai Chi, Qigong, Reiki, energy healing, making Reiki balls, working with energy and your own energy. I'm a Reiki master. When my Reiki master attuned me to level one, I was level one for the next 2 years. He would not give me my level two attunement for 2 years to make sure that level one energy integrated. That's why you can't just get Reiki done 1, 2, 3. It doesn't work that way. And you cannot get initiated into Reiki online. It's something that has to be done face to face with someone, okay? There's an energy transfer from master to disciple. Same thing in any initiation. Yeah, what'd you say?
We have to physically put our hands on you. Absolutely. To pump the energy into your system. And not just that, but we have to draw all of those symbols of the master attunement alignment process into your body. Like, we have to assign you and align you up and attune you to whatever sect of the Reiki practice that you're, that we're attuning you to. Either be a Sui, Omni, Sekhmet, Shetsum, it doesn't matter. We have to physically touch you, to put our hands on you. We have to draw.
We open your energy field up. We actually open up your whole energy field over your head.
Yeah.
We're talking about like crown chakra stuff going on over here.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
But Reiki, hands-on healing, you must learn how to do that for yourself, on yourself. Mm-hmm. The second thing you absolutely must understand, you have to have a basic understanding of astrology. I have just come to that point in my career as a witch after doing it for 20 years, saying you gotta understand the basics of astrology. You don't have to be an astrologer. You don't even have to. You should know how to calculate a birth chart. Fundamentally, you should know how to calculate a birth chart for someone and look at it and examine it and know what you're looking at. Number three, divination. You 100% need to know how to read oracle cards or tarot cards or bones or runes or shells or something. Yeah. But you have to have a divinational tool that is going to confirm for you what you're experiencing with the spiritual world. Physical, I'm talking about physical tools.
Yes.
Not all in your mind. Because even in practices like Santeria, Voodoo, Ifa, Palo, we as spiritists also rely on divination to confirm the will of the spirit. You have to have that.
Yeah.
Okay. Number four, what did I say? I said the Reiki, I said the divination, I said the astrology, herbs, plants, roots, trees, bones. You should understand how to work with herbs and plants. I'm going to say an unpopular opinion over here. You're not a witch if you don't know how to work with plants.
Mm-hmm. You're just an energy worker if you're not working with physical items.
Or you're a pagan, or you're a neo-pagan.
Right.
Or you're a goddess worshiper. Only people that cast spells are witches.
Mm-hmm.
Spell casting is what witchcraft is. It's not anything else. It's not meditation.
No, it's not manifestation.
It's not manifestation. It's working with plants and herbs, roots and bones and blood. It's working with all of that stuff. Okay. Yeah. That's number. And I can't remember what the last one is. Hold on. Don't come to me. I teach this shit and I can't even remember it.
Well, let's cover what
a lot of people got mad at me. A lot of people got mad at me because I said, if you're not working with plants, you're not a witch. Get the fuck over it. It's true.
It's true. It's very true. I'm sorry to be the bearer of bad news and to confirm and co-sign with what he just said, but it's true. If that hurts feelings, I'm sorry. We're not here to boost your ego. We're here to tell you the truth.
That's exactly.
Yup. Yeah, exactly. It's not kumbaya.
But just take all of that I just said and add dream work to it, and you have an entire spiritual practice right there.
Exactly. That is so true. Man.
Having snacks.
I love it. I'm loving this conversation. I'm so glad I popped in here. I wasn't even going to get up on TikTok. I was going to go to Instagram and my finger accidentally tapped on it on TikTok. And then you were the first person that popped up. I was like, Ryan, click.
And ancestors, you got to know who your ancestors are. You got to know that. Yeah. Because when you know who your ancestors are, then you'll know what kind of magic runs through your blood. It runs through your blood.
Oh yeah, magic is in the blood. That's true. That's very true. Even your gifts. I mean, there were ancient times where they would actually go around collecting children from villages that showed signs of these special gifts, and they would take them away to prepare and train them, and they would live in like the kingdom of those rulers as their oracles in the direct connection to the divine, so that a way they could interpret how to best defeat their enemies.
The last part that I do teach is, and we need to get into it more, is ceremonial and ritual magic.
Oh, that needs to be covered.
Ceremonial and ritual magic. That's a whole thing. Okay. Yeah. That's a whole, yeah.
I did a ritual not that long ago. It was good. It went fairly well. I'd say it went pretty well. Oh, well, my love, I am going to go. I'm going to get off of here and go to bed.
Me too.
All right.
I'm going to stuff a couple of more chips down and then I'm going to bed. Thank you, Derek. Love you. Thank you for coming out. Everybody, thank you for hanging out. I hope you learned something from us. Support us. Okay. Give us a boost. Buy our products. tell people about how great we are so that they buy readings from us and you can support us.
Yes.
We make money. Let me just say this before he goes. We're spiritual workers. Yes. Our whole life, we eat, sleep, breathe, shit, piss, and come spirituality. Okay. That's what we do. And our spirits support us by getting paid for being spiritual workers. Other people might be able to go out on the street and work at Starbucks. Yeah. I don't work at Starbucks. I get paid because I do spiritual work. So just, you know, support us, support people that do spiritual work. So because we need more spiritual workers in this world. Okay.
That is so true.
All right, everybody. Peace out. Have a great rest of the night.
Mwah. Good to see you, love.
Bye, guys. Good to see you. Bye.